Zinfandel is often regarded as a uniquely American wine. Some call it the wine of the people. Today I'm here at San Francisco's Fort Mason Center for the annual Zinfandel Festival from the Zinfandel Advocates and Producers. Let's go inside and see what they're pouring.
The wine that you're about to get poured is the 2009 Dolinsek Ranch Heirloom wine. I make what I call heirloom wines. They're not 75% Zinfandel. They're actually reflections of what is out in the field. So from our Bedrock vineyard, I make a Bedrock heirloom wine, which is about 50% Zinfandel and has the 26 other interplanted varieties. This vineyard is absolutely magnificent. I mean, it's for those of you who know the wines that Joe Swan used to make, this is the old Fratty Ranch. It's off of Laguna Road, so very cold part of Russian River Valley, and then on top of it, it's on a north-facing hillside, so it's even colder. In 2009, the vineyard popped at a quarter ton per acre, so literally like one vine, one cluster per vine, and even then we didn't harvest it until at 23 and a half bricks until the day before we got hit with 5 inches of rain on November 14th. So it's the hallmarks of Russian River Valley, and one of the reasons why I love Russian River Valley wines is that you get this really amazing acid structure in the wines. This actually comes in the pH here. The finished pH is about 3.4, which is sort of more like Chardonnay, Sauvignon Blanc levels than you typically see in red. And as a result, you get this very distinct, almost like boysenberry juice hue to it. So, you know, anytime you're on the pH scale, it runs from red to sort of purple, and it's really down on that purple side. The vineyard was planted in 1910, and it's about roughly 65-70% Zinfandel. The rest is Alicante Boucher, Petite Syrah, Teraldego, which is an aromatic red variety from Italy, which I think works a little bit like Viognier in this wine. It actually gives it a really sort of floral kick. And then there's some white stuff. There's Golden Chasselas, there's Muscat de Frontignan, there's Black Muscat, there's just all sorts of crazy shit out there. And it's a very cool variety. It's funny because there's people have different philosophies on this. Like one of my, what's that? Oh, sorry, the question was, there's so many varieties out there, are there any varieties that you don't use? And there's sort of different philosophies on this. For instance, one of my very close friends, Mike Officer, actually picks everything out separately and then blends it back because he's a control freak. Brilliant winemaker, but a control freak. And I just throw everything in. My general feeling is that these vineyards are a little bit like melting pots, and so, you know, you get the good and the bad and the ugly, and there's years where certain stuff doesn't get ripe, but then it'll be an acid ad. There's certain years where things, like in 2008, Petite Syrah pretty much fried off the vine before the Zinfandel was ready. So it just sort of, it's a give and take. So
Do you look for an aggregate number to pick, or is there a marker in that vineyard that if this is ready, everything's going to go? What are your clues to when to pick?
Well, I think Dad should answer that because he's picked a lot more of this. But generally, I would just say you pick on gestalt. You pretty much just walk into the vineyard and go, it feels ready.
Yeah. It looks ready. You actually, it is a little like putting your finger in the air. Yeah. You go through, and you know, really the marker for me in the vineyard is Zinfandel. Particularly because many of these vineyards are high percentage Zinfandel, meaning 20 to 60%. And Zinfandel is the great variety that actually collapses earliest in this group, if you will. So it's the one you measure, and you want it slightly overripe because there are going to be things in that mixed blend that are a little less ripe than Zinfandel. So you're picking Zinfandel slightly riper than you would ordinarily pick it, and knowing it's going to be compensated by things like the Carignan and the Petite Syrah, which are a little bit behind it. But they will be very close to being ripe, but they will sort of balance out the whole alcohol. So yeah, it really is. You walk into the vineyard, you do your measurements, you try to get as close as you can based on sugar and acid and all the rest of those things from a composite measurement. But at the end of the day, you look at the vines and you look at the grapes and you say, yeah, it's right, tastes good, yeah, let's go.
Can you comment on this concept of co-fermentation? What role does the white grape play in co-fermentation?
Well, co-fermentation has been used for years in Cote-Martin, where they co-ferment Viognier with Syrah, and it actually, the co-pigmentation, it actually means that when you have red grapes that are so dense in pigmentation and anthocyanin, like Alicante Boucher, for instance, that sometimes the color will just drop out of solution. By putting additional tannin in there, Viognier is a very tannic grape. A lot of these whites you see out in these field blends are very tannic white grapes. You actually give something for that extra anthocyanin to bond onto, so you actually ensure better color stability by co-fermenting the white grapes and the red grapes.
And is that something that they used to know 100 years ago and they've lost, or is this something that you see as winemaking practice?
I'm not sure if they put it in for co-pigmentation. Clearly they didn't know the idea of, you know, like, you know, bonding anthocyanins back in 1900. But clearly, they, you know, clearly it worked. And then the other thing is I think that they were looking for acidity. And, you know, a lot of these white varieties you see are aromatic white varieties. So you see things like muscats and things. And I think that that was 10,